India lecture series featuring John Chambers, founder and CEO, JC2 Ventures, Chairman Emeritus, Cisco. This was organized on Wednesday, September 26, 2018. After a welcome speech by Ambassador Sandeep Chakrabarty, John was introduced by Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh, Chandrababu Naidu. Later on, he sat down for chat with Diane Brady, who is also co-author of the book with him, Lessons for Leadership in a Startup World, Connecting the Dots. This conversation was followed by interactive Q&A session.
And not introduce John Chambers today, because Honorable Chief Minister will be talking about him. But I would take the opportunity to first thank USISPF and State Bank of India for partnering with us in this series of lectures. Today, John Chambers will be in conversation with Diane Brady.
It is a very rare opportunity to introduce a great personality, Mr. John Chambers. This book also, if you see, Connecting the Dots, Lessons for Leadership in Startup World. You know very well, he is going to change the world now for millions of startups, not one or two. That is the biggest inspiration. I am working with him as a well-wisher for the last 20 years, because in India, nobody used to work in technology continuously with persistence. I strongly believe technology will change the total world. It will bring transparency, accountability, and also speediness. Saying anything in this world, it is only imagination. Earlier, we used to read books in fiction. Now all these books who wrote on fiction, it is a reality now. So I am very happy to introduce him, and I wish him all the best. He is going to create a history in the near future. As on today, he has served on corporate world. Now he is going to create startup culture, not only in America, all over the world. I wish him all the best.
You write a lot about leaders you admire in the book, one of whom is Prime Minister Modi. And I'm curious, when you think about what it was that stood out about him, you know, because your relationship with India predates him, can you give me some sense of, you know, what it was you saw in him? A lot of people come with bold aspirations. Not everybody executes on it. But I'd love to just hear a little bit about that first.
Well, it's fascinating because when he got elected and I first started to follow him, I realized he outlines a vision and a strategy. And he outlines, and he does that himself. And he then breaks it down into the actionable areas that have to move. And then he's fearless in the implementation. And you saw that, whether it's on demonetization, and you saw it in the goods and services tax, et cetera. And so when I got asked to be the chairman of the US-India Strategic Partnership Forum, at that time Business Council, mm-hmm. I at first said no, and then I thought, what am I doing? This should be the model for the most strategic partnership between two countries in the world, not on trade, as it was started 45 years ago, but transforming each country. And so the ability to see that. You see it in Chief Minister Naidu. We've been friends for 20 years, but he outlines a vision for his state, and he's a dreamer like I am. And then he says, here are the elements that have to make that dream come true. And then he is fearless in going after it. So it is the leadership in India that I believe in, and a leadership that I think will be the fastest growing economy in the world for the next decade, that will be inclusive of 1.3 billion people. And rather than India being a very slow follower, and not known for innovation, I believe that India will lead in innovation and be a model for the world on the speed of change. And I think the U.S. and India can learn a lot from each other in this process. So to be a small part of that is exciting.
So working with the Chief Minister, Mr. Chandrababu Naidu, is an amazing experience because the gentleman works 17 to 18 hours a day, completely focused. There's no confusion at all. From morning to night, he is working. While he's walking, there is a meeting. While he's having food, there's a meeting. While he's going in the flight, there are meetings. He never wastes a single minute of his time. And for all of us, it's very inspiring to work under him because we see the passion, we see the possibility of taking part in creating history by bringing our population above the poverty lines and also by creating literacy, by creating good health conditions. In fact, the aim of the Chief Minister is to as against the 2030 set by United Nations to bring all the sustainable development goals into practice in Andhra Pradesh by 2022, and all of us want to be a part of that story.
So I'm delighted to be standing in the presence of Chandrababu Naiduji, and he is a visionary as we all know, and now as your focus is towards organic farming, I think that is also telling us that you think far ahead of the time. And here in America also organic farming is such a big thing. So how you came to this decision?
No, we wanted to. I am very strong in technology. Technology and nature will go together. With the technology, if you protect nature, if you promote nature, then we can do wonders. That is why we are going for ZBNF. It is a revolution. This is the biggest product we are going to hand over to the global community. From India. Now United Nations is working with us. You know very well, I am very strong in technology. Now we are going Internet of Things and also innovations, ultimately startup. Again, we are going artificial intelligence, big data analytics, predictive analytics, everything we are working. With all these things again, ZBNF, zero budget natural farming is the reality. If you can clinch that, we can protect and promote environment. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, we can answer so many problems.
I'm really excited, and just a supplementary small question, looking at the paucity of time that you have. I heard you work 17 hours a day, and everywhere you go, there is work following you. Where do you derive that strength, and who would you say is the role model or source of inspiration for you?
Always, I strongly believe work is worship. And at the same time, if you do something for society, you will have so much of energy. I enjoy work, so no fatigue. I am deriving so many inspirations from so many people, on technology front somebody, on ethics front somebody, like that. But all these things, I am pulling in myself, and I am dedicating for the service of the poor.
Thank you very much. We are honored to have a leader like you, sir. Consul General Sandeep Chakravarti Sahab, today's India lecture series, wonderful, inspiring, and I think you got a very special speaker today to address and talk to us about the excitement generated by the presence of Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh, who himself introduced him as his friend.
देखिए आज तो सोने पे सुहागा हो गया. ये जो सीरीज शुरू करी है ये काफी लोकप्रिय हो गया है. और जब जॉन चैम्बर्स ने रुचि प्रकट करी कि वो आना चाहते हैं इस लेक्चर को देने के लिए तो हम खुश हुए. लेकिन जब ऑनरेबल चीफ मिनिस्टर साहब को पता चला कि वो आ रहे हैं तो वो अचानक उन्होंने फैसला किया कि हम भी आएंगे. तो ये पहले हम लोगों को पता नहीं था, ये अचानक ये हुआ, बट बहुत अच्छा हुआ. और जो जॉन चैम्बर्स बात करते हैं उसका मुझे लगता है ज़मीन पे उसका जो एग्जीक्यूशन है वो हमारे लीडर्स जैसे चंद्रबाबू नायडू हैं या प्राइम मिनिस्टर मोदी हैं वो कर रहे हैं. और आपने देखा होगा जॉन चैम्बर्स के जो स्पीच या टॉक थी उसमें कई बार उन्होंने इन दोनों नेताओं का उल्लेख किया कि वो कह रहे थे कि ये जो नेताएँ हैं इस नेता हैं ये समझते हैं, उनके पास विजन है, वो समझते हैं क्या क्या करना है. विजन के बाद स्ट्रेटजी, उसके बाद एक्शन. ये तीन जो स्टेजेस हैं किसी भी कार्य करने को वो ये नेता समझते हैं. और बड़े एक्साइटेड थे, बड़े पॉजिटिव थे भारत के बारे में. और इनका इतने बड़े कॉरपोरेशन को चलाने का तजुर्बा है तो जब ये बात करते हैं भारत के बारे में, ऑप्टिमिज्म प्रकट करते हैं तो हमको बहुत बहुत सच लगता है.
बहुत संक्षिप्त में उनकी पुस्तक का शीर्षक है कनेक्टिंग द डॉट, लेसन्स फॉर अ लीडर. तो आपको क्या लगता है कौन सा ऐसा लेसन जो आप ने उनकी बातचीत से अपने लिए रेलेवेंट पाया?
देखिए, उनकी जो बात थी वो बार बार एक बात कहते रहे कि देखिए, शुरुआत हर कोई करता है लेकिन स्केल अप में लोग मार खा जाते हैं। एक रेस्टोरेंट, एक छोटी सी दुकान अपने घर पे हर कोई चला लेता है, लेकिन क्या वो चेन चला पाता है, क्या वो चेन ऑफ रेस्टोरेंट चला पाता है? तो उनकी जो, क्योंकि अब जब तक वो नहीं करेंगे आप नौकरियाँ तैयार नहीं कर पाएंगे, जॉब क्रिएशन नहीं होगा। तो ये जो स्केलिंग अप की बात है, मुझे लगता है उनकी इस किताब में सबसे इम्पॉर्टेंट बात है और ये हम सबको पढ़ना चाहिए, क्योंकि भारत में अभी जो डिमांड है नौकरियों की वो बहुत ज़्यादा है। हमारी युवा की संख्या बहुत अत्यधिक है विश्व में, हमारे लिए ये बहुत अच्छी बात है, लेकिन इनके लिए जॉब्स क्रिएट करना पड़ेगा और ये बड़े कॉरपोरेशन नहीं कर पाएंगे, सरकार भी नहीं सीमित है कर पाने में। ये स्टार्टअप इकोसिस्टम से आएगा, स्टार्टअप से कर पाएंगे। तो मुझे लगता है कि ये काफ़ी रेलिवेंट है इनकी किताब हम लोगों के लिए, हमें पढ़ना चाहिए। हमें समझ नहीं है कि कैसे स्केल अप कर सकते हैं।
और लास्टली, आपके ये सौभाग्य है, न्यूयॉर्क में बहुत महत्वपूर्ण हस्तियाँ भारत से आती रहती हैं और अभी विदेश मंत्री पधारी हुई हैं सुषमा स्वराज जी, उनकी इस यात्रा के दौरान क्या विशेष बात आपकी दृष्टि में रही है या रहने वाली है?
देखिए, ये जो यूनाइटेड नेशन जनरल असेंबली का समय है ये बहुत इम्पॉर्टेंट इसलिए है क्योंकि विश्व भर से नेता यहाँ आते हैं और बहुत ही संक्षिप्त समय में बहुत लोगों से मुलाकात हो जाती है। तो जो संबंध जो थोड़े पुराने हो जा रहे हैं या जहाँ लोगों से मुलाकात आज तक नहीं हो पाई, तो मुझे लग रहा है कि वो उनका जो कार्यक्रम है बहुत ही पैक्ड है। वो कई, मतलब मैं संख्या बताना में ही असंभव होगा, इतने सारे नेताओं से, इतने सारे एक्टिविटीज़, इतने सारे इवेंट्स हैं, लेकिन ये बहुत अच्छा है। बहुत एनर्जी के साथ वो सबसे मिल रही हैं और हमारा जो बायलैटरल रिलेशंस और मल्टीलैटरल रिलेशंस है वो एक तरीके से रिन्यू हो जाता है। तो ये UNGA का टाइम बहुत महत्वपूर्ण है और सुषमा जी बिल्कुल दिन रात लगी हुई हैं, सबसे मुलाकात कर रही हैं।
Talking to Shankar Narayanan ji, CEO of State Bank of India, New York branch, and he and his bank also jointly organized today's lecture series. Talk to us a little bit about what you heard from the gentleman John today, who was also introduced by none other than Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh. Was there something that you felt resonated with you based on your experience as CEO with SBI?
He talked about the startup and the trials and tribulations they undergo and how an innovation can fructify into a success and what are the hurdles they face. And coming from a person who has headed the largest networking company, Cisco, and with his experience in the corporate world and now dwelling into a startup and helping the youngsters, I think it's a great lesson, and also he will be leading by example. So I think it was very convincing, and I'm sure the youngsters should be mentored by him.
Lessons for a Leader, that is the title of the book. So based on the conversation today, what is the top one lesson that you think is relevant for all leaders?
If you read the, Jim Collins, Good to Greatness, he talks of level 5 leadership, level 1, level 2, level 5. And level 5, he talks of humility. And all the great leaders, you will find they're humble people. Let it be Abul Kalam, or let it be Bill Gates. And similarly, John was very humble. Though he had been the leader of Cisco, which is one of the largest company, he was humble. And now he says, I have done enough in corporate world. I want to help the human population, and he has a passion for India, and he has passion for youngsters, and he is looking at the mankind in general, and that is something amazing, and that is what a true leader is about, what he pays back to the society.
I'm Ashok Vyas here at Indian Consulate. I have the pleasure of talking to J. Krishna Kishoreji, who is CEO of Economic Development Board, Andhra Pradesh, and he is one of the delegates with the Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh, Chandrababu Naiduji, here. So talk to us a little bit about the focus of this visit.
We have come here on the 24th of September for attending two very important functions in New York. The first function being a a major initiative from United Nations Environment Program to highlight the zero-based, zero-budget natural farming in Andhra Pradesh. Andhra Pradesh is now growing nearly 500,000 acres of land, completely organic farming. And the idea is to have sustainable livelihood for farmers, at the same time promote health of the farmers, health of the consumers, by not having any kind of chemicals or fertilizers in the plants grown, at the same time contribute to the well-being of the nature and environment. So this is a very bold move undertaken by the Chief Minister, Mr. Chandrababu Naidu, in the state of Andhra Pradesh. And his aim is now to have the entire state go for organic farming by 2024. This move of his has drawn a great deal of appreciation from United Nations Environment Program. There was a very big function held on 24th. Subsequent to that, we had another very important event in World Economic Forum. The Andhra Pradesh Economic Development Board, which I represent as CEO, actually promotes investments in the state of Andhra Pradesh, develops long-term strategies for economic growth, and also acts as a foreign office of the government of Andhra Pradesh. Apart from that, we are dealing with all multilateral, bilateral agencies across the world. Now, the Andhra Pradesh Economic Development Board and the World Economic Forum have come forward with a study on the impact of Industry 4.0 and its relation to sustainable growth and development. So this study was conducted in the state of Andhra Pradesh across various departments and across various organizations and companies in the state. And it has come to a conclusion that nearly $5 billion of savings as well as opportunity would be earned per year in Andhra Pradesh by implementing Industry 4.0. The World Economic Forum has selected Andhra Pradesh because of the excellent e-governance initiatives being taken by the Honorable Chief Minister, and also for the very proactive measures being taken to promote artificial intelligence and cutting-edge technologies across the state. So these two were the major functions. Apart from that, we had United States-India Strategic Partnership Forum meeting, a very important meeting held on 25th. We also had a meeting of USIBC and a couple of other important marquee meetings.
Such a wonderful response to your focus, and the way you shared all these details tells us why you are CEO of such an important board. And let us look at ground realities from the point of view of farmers. Organic farming, it's a cool thing. It is internationally appreciated and all. But traditionally, the kind of mindset that farmers have, when they are introduced to organic farming, what has been their response? Number one. Number two, in terms of the returns on their yields that they are getting or are likely to get, what is the study saying about that?
And I thank you very much for asking this very good question. In fact, it has been a very pleasant experience in Andhra Pradesh. Now, 500,000 acres are already being cultivated in organic farming for the past nearly 3 years now. And the most important thing is the farms being cultivated are in small and marginal farms. That means the lesser privileged among the farmers are able to successfully take to organic farming. And the experience has shown that their income levels have risen because people like to eat food which doesn't contain chemicals. We all are very well aware the damage which chemicals and fertilizers are doing, the pesticides are doing to the health of people, the raising incidence of cancer, the raising incidence of various forms of diseases is very much evident. So this awareness has come even up to the village level in Andhra Pradesh thanks to the proactive measures of the state government. And so the farmers themselves are very happy to take to cultivation. And because of the good positive health impact, there are a lot of people are actually consuming this particular food. And we are confident that worldwide there will be a lot of demand for organic farming. So it's bound to give a lot of income to the farmers.
It's a great honor to be standing with John Chambers and the gentleman whose book, Connecting the Dots, Lessons for a Leader, was introduced before launch here at the Indian Consulate by none other than Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh, Chandrababu Naidu. Talk to me a little bit about what was it that prompted you to conceive structure of this book.
Well, what prompted me is that I'm a believer that startups worldwide, whether it's in India, the U.S., or in Europe, will be the primary job creators for the world. And that if we don't have dramatically more startups that also scale well, we are going to leave behind many of our people in every state in India and every state in the U.S. So what I learned was when I dealt with startups, and it didn't matter if I was in New Delhi or Silicon Valley, the questions were similar. And I realized that if I could write a book helping people to understand the challenges, how you deal with setbacks, how do you build an organization, how do you learn to get close to customers, how do you work with governments to achieve common goals, how do you do an acquisition, how do you build a strong culture, that could play a role perhaps in scaling organizations far more. Now, I could be talking to each one individually. And it's really the platform that I believe in for this next generation for the entire world. In it, I probably mention India more than any other country except the U.S. And it gives you an idea of how much I care about the country. But I believe your prime minister and your country will be a role model for others, including the U.S.
So, John, allow me to say that the general impression is Indian prime minister is more technology savvy than the current president of America. Do you agree with that impression?
Well, I've been so good in politics, you know I won't answer that question directly. But what I do believe is that I think the Prime Minister Modi has outlined a very good strategy for digitization of the country and how do you create a startup nation and how do you change the education system and how do you do it across smart cities in an inclusive fashion. I think there's things that India can learn from the U.S. I think there's some things in India that the U.S. can learn from India. And I think a digitization plan, like you see in India, is one of the things the U.S. could learn from. And a startup approach in this country is something that I think the U.S. could learn from as well. So I think there are two leaders that have learned to get along very well. And if you watch, and I watched them in their relationships and their balance, they're focused on the common win-win approaches, not the differences.
Absolutely. And quickly, do you foresee a situation where in India, we will have companies like Facebook and Google starting from that land? Right now, we have CEOs for such big companies emerging from India, but we don't have any original idea related big company that came to being in India?
Well, to be very candid, India did not have the right environment for a startup nation looking back 5, 10, 15 years ago, and often did not deal with the key issues on everything from intellectual property to supportive government to a currency that was traded the effective way to even how you did goods and services taxes. Those things have now changed. And so you forget that when I was at Cisco in 1991, it was 10, 20 years later before we became the recognized leader on a scale on a global basis. And the same thing is true of today's high-tech leaders in Silicon Valley. They're 20 years old. And so I think the real key is, will we have these companies 10 and 20 years from now in India? I think the answer is yes. But you have to get a number of startups growing, and then they have to execute well. And that's what we've been missing. We haven't had the right environments for startups to grow and scale. I think you're seeing this prime minister and this country and the young people in your country, perhaps most important, realize they want to be part of a startup. So I think that will come.
And last question, sir. You, as you mentioned, you were CEO of Cisco. Being a CEO of such a big company with that prestige, and I'm sure with that kind of money, once you retire, then you just want to relax if you are not John Chambers. So there is something in John Chambers that is inspiring him to work with missionary zeal to inspire youth and start startups in various parts of the world. Where do you get that energy and vision?
Well, my wife would be the first one to say the energy is almost inherent. I got very lucky in that I have a very high energy level. But I also like to change the world one more time. And I believe those most successful in life owe an obligation to give back, true of companies and true of individuals. And this is my passion. I love it. My pupils literally dilate when I think about helping a startup and then watch them be successful. And so in this next chapter in my life, I want to perhaps play a role similar to what I did at Cisco, where the internet changed the way the world works, lives, learns, and plays, and we played a huge role in changing that. And with startups, I hope to play a role of helping startups be the model for the future. And I think almost all job creation will come from these startups. So that I'm passionate about. And at this stage of my life, I only do the things that I really love and care about. I really love India, really care about India's success. And the relationship between the U.S. and India, I think, must be the most strategic in the world. When I started saying that 4 years ago, people said, no, John. It's funny how many people today are realizing it should be and can be.
So great, such a lovely person, and sharing with love all that he has in terms of knowledge and experience with the world to make the world a better place and help people. So one last image that I have is, no question, but the image is the sun rises and there is glow and there are crops. And the way your bright knowledge is radiating and seeing startups grow, it's a beautiful scenario. Lots of good wishes, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It's an honor. Thank you.